So we discussed instrument which measures the solar radiation, and solar radiation, the type of solar radiation can be divided into two different type of solar radiation. That is, one is global, that is the total, and the other one is direct. And the difference between them is diffuse radiation. So diffuse and direct or beam, they are the two parts, and then when you make the sum, you get the total radiation. So this pyranometer measures the sum of the two, diffuse and beam or direct. So basically it measures global or total radiation. And what is the principle of measurement, etc.? Those things were discussed, right? So what is basically happening is you have the solar radiation passing through both the glass hemispheres. Glass hemispheres, the purpose is to protect the this disk here, black absorber disk, from weather, as well as not allow loss of heat from the surface of the absorber disk. And these glass hemispheres should have very good or very high transmissivity. Then the absorber disk absorbs the solar radiation, and the radiation, electromagnetic waves, basically get converted into heat, and that increases the temperature of the absorber plate. Now basically you convert that heat or higher temperature into, you want to convert it into another signal, electrical signal, that is the millivolt signal or microvolt signal. So you use the principle of thermocouple. So in thermocouple, you have two junctions, hot junction and cold junction. The hot junction is at a higher temperature. The cold junction is kept at a zero, at 0 degrees Celsius, which is the reference junction. And then you find that because of this temperature difference, because of the Seebeck effect, the voltage is generated, and this voltage is measured, and in some narrow range. Of course, it depends upon the characteristic of the material that is making the, that is used to make the thermocouple, which is made up of two dissimilar materials. So you get a millivolt signal because of the temperature difference. And this a millivolt signal in a narrow range is proportional to the temperature of the hot junction. Right, so that principle is used here to get the millivolt signal, which should be proportionate to the radiation that is falling on the black absorber plate, which gets converted into heat and increases the temperature. But now here you are not keeping the cold junction at 0 degrees Celsius temperature, so you should have some signal which compensate for that difference. Okay, so there is another plate, four, you can see, compensating disk. So that compensates the difference in the signal produced because of the temperature not being equal to 0 degrees Celsius, but it is rather at ambient temperature. So this four is near ambient temperature, and using that as reference, a correcting signal is produced. So there is some electronics built into this. Five is your, of course, sensing element, which is thermocouple, or rather they are in series. Multiple thermocouples are put in series, which is called thermopile, which increases the amplitude of the signal, and you can measure it more accurately. So some refinement in the signal is necessary. So some electronics built into this, and finally the millivolt signal is transmitted to some instrument. It can be a millivolt meter, or it can be a device like this, which is a readout device, which directly shows the watt per meter square, that is solar radiation intensity. It is calibrated for the solar radiation intensity or solar irradiance for the given millivolt signal. And this guard disc basically protects the parts of the pyranometer, not just from sun actually, more so from the rain. And this is, in weather stations, it is generally kept horizontal, right? Because like horizontal position is a general purpose. We don't know whether a particular application, the collector is put at what angle. So for general purpose, the weather stations would measure it for the horizontal plane. But for a particular purpose of testing of a collector, it may be put at some inclined angle. If you are interested in total radiation falling on a particular inclined plane. So as you can see here in this figure, A and B, in case of A, it is kept on the horizontal plane, and what it is measuring, you can see it accepts beam radiation or direct radiation directly coming from the sun, and it also accepts radiation coming from all this 180 degrees, the hemisphere of the sky, that is ID, the diffuse radiation. So basically it will provide you the measure of total radiation or global radiation. Now, in some cases, your collector, or in many of the cases, your collector is not kept horizontal, and you want to directly get, you don't want to do some calculations. So you might put your pyranometer at the collector angle, as it is shown here, beta. Beta can be the collector angle, right? Tilt angle. We have talked about different angles, and at that time, that this angle beta was told that this is the notation used for tilt angle. So let's say your collector is kept at beta, the tilt angle. Then if you are interested in a collector, knowing the input energy to the collector, the total input energy to the collector, then you might put your pyranometer parallel to the collector plane, right? So that is another way one might use a pyranometer, if the input energy to the collector, the total input energy, the sum of all type of radiation is required. Now, as we will see later, there are different types of collectors. Some of the collectors are focusing collector, and some of the others are flat plate collectors. So the flat plate collectors can use beam as well as diffuse radiation, while the focusing collectors can use only beam radiation. So in case of focusing collectors or concentrating type of collector, for example, the parabolic trough type of collector, you are many times or most of the times not interested in getting the ID value, diffuse radiation. You don't want that, because what you are saying is my input is only beam radiation. This IB is my input. So in that case, you may not want to get ID, or it may not be needed for you. But in case of flat plate collectors, let's say solar water heater, in that case, it's a flat plate collector. So for it, this IB as well as ID, both of them are useful. So even if, let's say, this IB is almost zero, even then this ID would be used to heat up the water, right? So like some solar water heater manufacturers claim that even in cloudy weather, it will be able to produce some heat. Right, of course, the magnitude of that will be very small as compared to when the sky is clear. But then the thing is that a flat plate collector is able to use diffuse as well as beam radiation. So in such cases, you are interested to know the total input energy, which is sum of the direct radiation as well as diffuse radiation. Now, you need to understand, because this diagram is helpful to explain that concept, which we will talk about maybe later in this lecture, but a suitable diagram may not be available there, so I would like to explain that here also. As you can see, I have been talking about this beam radiation and diffuse radiation, but there is another radiation which is also falling on this pyranometer, and that is nothing but, you can read this, reflected from surface if instrument is above ground level. Okay, instrument is above ground level, and another important thing is that this beta is not equal to zero. Beta is equal to zero, it means it is a horizontal collector. So don't just consider this pyranometer, let's say consider this whole line, and let's say it represents the surface of solar collector, which is made inclined at angle beta. Now, if you keep the collector horizontal, okay, if you keep it horizontal, then beta is equal to zero. In that case, the two type of radiation are available on horizontal plane, beam and diffuse, which make the total, or rather we may call it global. But when you make the collector inclined like this, what happens is it also receives some radiation from the ground, as you can see. So some of the this beam and diffuse radiation get reflected from the ground, and it can fall, or it a part of it falls on the pyranometer, or you may be talking about the collector surface. So the collector surface also receives some reflected radiation from the ground, but of course ground is not having reflectivity equal to 1, so whatever falls on that, only a small part of it is reflected, which may be available to this collector. So the reflectivity to 1. Yeah. Reflectivity is 0.2, right? Okay. So reflectivity is nearly 0.2 when it is sand, or when it is grass. Right, so not all the radiation falling on the ground gets reflected, only 20% of it in many cases get reflected, and there are, and it may be captured by your collector which is made inclined. So you might feel that yes, you get extra radiation if you keep the collector inclined, but now here we are talking about only the collectors which are put on which are not surrounded by heighted structures, right? It is on, let's say, on put up on a very big ground, or they are put on the terrace and they are not facing any tall structures. Otherwise, the things will become very complicated. So we are not discussing such cases. So let's say it is put up at some height, but it is on the ground. So you get some reflected radiation, which you might feel that you get extra radiation, but then you are also losing some radiation. You can read this part. This diffuse radiation is not measured. So they are talking about pyranometer. So they are saying this diffuse radiation is not measured. If you're talking about the collector, this line, then this collector does not receive radiation from the sky on its backside. Right, there is some sky. When it is horizontal, it can see the whole sky 180 degrees, but when it is made inclined, it becomes blind to the sky on its backside, right? So it is not able to utilize the diffuse radiation which is coming from that part of the sky. So when you make the collector inclined, as if you remember and recall, and if you understood, you know that the collector may be inclined to get more radiation on its surface, right? But that is particularly true about the beam radiation. As we will take one example, you will understand that part. So the availability, when you make it inclined, generally the purpose is to increase the availability of beam radiation. But the availability of diffuse radiation decreases when you make the collector inclined. But of course, as you will note, as you will observe in the example that we do later, that the loss of this may not be very high due to different reasons. And the gain again from the reflector radiation also may not be very high, right? Okay, so one important thing to be understood here is that when you make the collector inclined to the horizontal plane, you lose some part of diffuse radiation because now the collector is not able to see the whole sky 180 degrees, but you are losing some part of the sky and losing that radiation. But there is some additional, you can say it now sees the ground. So the radiation which is reflected from that part of the ground is received by this collector. And you might be interested in finding the total radiation falling on that collector, which will give you the input energy. So you might put your pyranometer on that surface, parallel to that surface. So in that case, whatever is the reading given by this collector becomes your input energy. And then what is the output of your collector? You measure that, and output upon input gives you the efficiency of the collector. So if you are testing a collector, you are testing an inclined collector, you might install the pyranometer like this on an inclined surface. Okay, it may not be mounted directly on the solar collector, but it may be put on some surface close to the solar collector, which is made inclined at the same angle. Okay. Now let us talk about one more parameter of this pyranometer, and which is called sensitivity of pyranometer, which is like given in the manual of the pyranometer. So basically, it is the output millivolt or microvolt signal divided by the input solar irradiance, and it is generally supposed to be a constant. So the pyranometer manufacturer would provide you the sensitivity of pyranometer, which is in microvolt per watt per meter square. I is in watt per meter square, the irradiance. And generally, it is in the range of 10 to 15 microvolt per watt per meter square. So let's say the input solar radiation is 750 watts, right? So in that case, if sensitivity is, let's say, 10, then you would produce 7500 microvolt or 7.5 millivolt signal. So this millivolt signal will be measured, and either it is displayed as millivolt, then you have to use this sensitivity, you have to convert it into watt per meter square, or you may use a readout device where it is direct, which is calibrated and directly displays the solar radiation intensity in watt per meter square. Okay. So this is about pyranometer. There are some other instruments also which are like more economical, and they also may give you the global or total radiation, but they are they are economical, but they compromise in quality, and they don't give you the perfect reading of the input energy, or the they are not able to cover the whole spectrum of solar radiation. So silicon photodiode or reference cells may be used. Reference cells particularly are used for measurement of input energy to the solar photovoltaic panels. Okay, and these silicon photodiodes are able to respond to only 0.4 to 1.1 micrometer, and you know that for solar energy, the spectrum up to 4 micrometer is important. Shows the silicon photodiode and the reference cell which might be used to as an economical tools to get the performance or compare the performance of your solar collector. It can be thermal or it can be solar PV with the standard one.
Right.
Okay. Now, one might be interested in getting. Now, this pyranometer will give you the total. It won't give you two parts. The direct and the diffuse, those two parts you don't know separately. Let's say total is 800, but then you don't know out of that how much is beam and how much is diffuse. Now if you are, let's say, using a concentrating type of collector, you are interested in the beam radiation and not in diffuse radiation. Or there are chances that you want to get the both type of radiation separately. And you want to know both the things, that is beam as well as diffuse radiation. So in that case, one might use a device called shading ring. Right. So I'm showing you one type of shading ring, which is somewhat easy to understand, like how it provides you diffuse radiation. Right. So you can use the shading ring in combination with pyranometer to get diffuse radiation. To understand the principle, which is which seems to be very simple, you can look at this diagram on the right hand side, and you see this pyranometer here, and you see this gray belt here, and one rectangle shown here, which is the cross section of this shading ring, which is the cross section of this shading ring. So what this shading ring does is it basically blocks all direct radiation falling on the pyranometer. It seems that the glass hemisphere is not completely shaded, but actually the whole glass hemisphere gets completely shaded. So either you can reduce the size of this hemisphere, or you can increase the size of this strip. Right. So this strip, now it's the cross section of this shading ring. Now, why do you need it in shape of a ring? You need it in shape of a ring because the position of the sun is not going to remain steady in the sky, the east-west movement during the day. So during the whole day, it should be blocking at the same position. This ring will remain at the same position during a day, on a given day. But still, when the sun moves from east to west, all the time it blocks the beam radiation, doesn't allow it to fall on the glass hemisphere of the pyranometer. But the pyranometer is still able to get all radiation coming from the remaining sky. And because of this, you get the diffuse radiation only. So with the help of this, you can get diffuse radiation. You can have another pyranometer which gives you total radiation, so total minus diffuse will give you the beam radiation, in case you're interested in the beam radiation. Of course, you have another instrument which can give you directly the beam radiation, but it is much more costlier as compared to pyranometer, right? So pyranometer cost, I told you that it can exceed 1.5 lakhs, or two pyranometers plus shading ring could cost you somewhere around 5 lakh rupees. But the other instrument, which is pyraliometer, which we will discuss later or just after this, can cost you somewhere around 15 lakh rupees, because in that case you need a sun tracker also, right? So if you want to get diffuse radiation, then you can use a combination of pyranometer and shading ring. Right now, this shading ring, the one part of it is this ring, and then you have one this bar here, and then there is a arc, the slot in arc shape here, and there is a support, right? So there are two adjustments to be made here. One is one time adjustment, and that is for the latitude. So depending upon where you are putting this, you are going to adjust it on this bar. right? So like the inclination of this will basically depend upon, inclination will depend upon the latitude angle, and then you are going to slide this according to the seasonal movement of the sun. So that is according to declination angle, right? Declination angle is like it is changing continuously because the when as the season changes, as the the plane in which the sun is moving is continuously shifting, right? So as that shifts, you have to shift this this one, right? So you don't have to you don't need generally to adjust it every day. You can do it weekly also. So you will have graduation here where the declination angle would be shown. So accordingly, you can adjust the angle, right? So you need to do two adjustments. One, the declination adjustment, and another, the latitude. Latitude is generally like when it is put up at a particular place. Let's say you're putting it up at a weather station. So weather station is at a particular location. So you adjust the latitude only once, but the declination adjustment is required in a few days. So this is the principle of the shading ring with which you can get the diffuse radiation. So two adjustments are to be done, and it blocks the solar radiation direct, the beam one, and you get the diffuse radiation. Of course, this design of shading ring which was shown is not always used. Most of them use this design again you have to use the two adjustments, one for the latitude and another for the seasonal one, right? So this is showing you the principle of measurements, but will not means how it blocks the radiation all the time, right? But we will not go into details of this. Just one design would be enough to like convey you the basic principle, how it blocks the direct radiation and provides you the diffuse radiation. So if you want to get beam radiation, as I told you, you need to have two pyranometers, right? And one will be the pair of pyranometer and shading ring, which will give you diffuse. The other one will give you global. The difference gives you the beam radiation. But then that will be less accurate. Okay. So you might want to get the beam radiation directly. The instrument used for that is called pyraheliometer, right? There is a small difference in the spelling and pronunciation. It's pyraheliometer, right? It's pyraheliometer. So this pyraheliometer has different parts, like there is a collimeter tube. One what is shown, this one is this outer one. It's not the ray that we are talking about. One is this outer tube, which is called collimator tube. Then there are baffles inside. You can see this. They are the baffles. Then you have a tracking mechanism, two-axis tracking mechanism, right? Two-axis tracking mechanism. So this one is two-axis tracking mechanism. So this has to track the sun continuously. The face, this one, has to always be in the direction of the sun. And then you have this alignment indicator here. This line gives you the alignment indicator. Like you have the lenses here, and that gives you with the help of that you can know whether it is properly aligned with the sun ray direction or not. Then the tracking mechanism. Then the absorber plate. Now the principle of measurement is very similar to the pyranometer, right? So what you have here is the absorber plate, but the absorber plate is not like a pyranometer. It is put in this you can say a deep cylinder, right? And the sun ray, not all sun rays are able to enter. Once you have adjusted the orientation, the sun rays only at 5 degree acceptance angle would be able to fall on this absorber plate, right? Actually, these lines have shifted a bit. So phi is this absorber plate and 6 is something below that, and that is nothing but that thermopile, which is the sensing instrument, right? So the only beam radiation is able to fall on the rest gets absorbed inside, either doesn't is not able to enter, or some stray radiation or diffuse radiation enters, then it gets absorbed inside the tube. Okay, and only thing that can fall on this is beam radiation in the acceptance angle range of 5 degrees, and you have to always keep it facing the sun. And this ideally, like manually, if you want to do it, then it will be done with this alignment indicator. But generally, it's not feasible to do it manually. You have a tracking mechanism or an automatic tracking mechanism with the help of which it will always be kept facing the sun. So you get this beam radiation on this absorber plate, which gets heated. Its temperature increases, and you have hot junction here, and then the required electronics here to compensate for this zero degrees Celsius, or the because of the ambient temperature not being zero, whatever is the error introduced, that is gets corrected, and finally the millivolt signal provided to the readout device. So other things are similar to a pyranometer, but only difference is that this accepts only beam radiation and provides you the measurement of beam radiation. So this instrument, because of the this part, the tracking mechanism makes it very costly. But still, all weather stations generally they use this pyranometer, which looks like this. So at the bottom here, you will have that absorber plate, which gives you the signal, and this is the transmission cable, which will be connected with a readout device, right? And this is the inlet part of this, right? And this guard actually protects it, if it is put at a very cold cold atmosphere, and the snow or the rain is there, then this upper cap will protect the device from that, right? And it will not fall on this mirror, or rather the lens. Okay, and you might have some heating element also here, which keeps it frost or snow free. Okay, so this is about pyranometer, which measures the beam radiation, not direct radiation. There is another instrument called sunshine recorder. It actually doesn't give you solar radiation intensity, but it rather gives you number of hours for which clear sunshine is available. Right. Recorder is shown here. It has parts like there is a ball, this, and it has grooves, as you can see below here, and it is put on a platform, and there is a glass sphere, and in these grooves you put strips like this, card strips like this. This is a mechanical instrument. Nowadays, for convenience, people don't go for mechanical devices and go for electronic devices. But this is the basic principle of measurement of the number of clear sunshine hours. So you have this card strip. I don't know whether you can read or not. Here it is winter card, here it is equinoctial card, and here it is summer card. So there are basically three grooves in this: one groove for winter, another for summer, and one for in the middle for the equinoctial period. So when you are in winter, you will be using this winter card. It will insert it at a proper groove in that. The card can be a paper card, And what happens is this glass sphere accepts the radiation from the sun and focuses it according to season on a particular groove where you have inserted the card. And it's like the play which we also used to do and use a convex lens to burn focus the sunlight or solar radiation onto paper and burn it, right? So similar thing happens here. You have a card here, which is a paper card, and you have the glass sphere here, which focuses the solar radiation onto it. So when there is clear sunlight available, sunshine available, the intensity is enough to burn this and leave a burn mark on this card. So the length of this burn mark basically gives you number of hours. And there are some graduations on this, as may be seen. In the middle it is 12, and then here it must be morning, and here it is written 15. This gives you how many number of hours the clear sunshine was available, right? It's a mechanical method of measuring that. And then equinoctial, how many hours it was available, that is seen here. And the summer card will have the longest day length. So it will give you, it tells you that there are more number of hours for which the clear sunshine was available. Of course, if it is monsoon, then in between, if the clouds are coming, then you won't have this burn mark, and you know that during this particular period there was no clear sunshine available. But this mechanical method does not give you a perfect number, and in a way it will be just a qualitative measurement that you get, not exactly quantitative measurement. Now this type of device, at least in weather stations, it won't be used, and you would have some kind of sensor which will record for the time period during which a clear sunshine. So you may define it at a particular level, let's say 100 or 200 watt per meter square. Whenever it exceeds that, it records that period, and finally it tells you today how many hours the sunshine exceeded a particular value, let's say 200 watt per meter square, right? So a sensor would do that job instead of this mechanical device. So you may have such tables available based on that. The important information given by this is number of sunshine hours. So more the sunshine hours, more the solar energy availability, right? So this has been taken from a book which gives the data from different meteorological stations in different parts of India. So you may focus on the location which is known to you, and let's say we talk about Ahmedabad. So as you can see, in Ahmedabad, this January you have 10 hours clear sunshine. Then this is not measured over a day. It should represent the whole year. Measurement has to be done the whole year or for multiple years, and for those years representative years will be chosen, or it will be giving the average over some years. Right, so as you can see, in January, number of hours for which the clear sunshine, because the day is somewhat shorter, it is 10. For February, it is a bit higher. March, it is bit less. and then but still somewhat more than February, so sometimes the clouds may be coming. Then April is 11.2, and then May is highest 11.4, the longest days. Okay, June it should actually be higher than May, but then because of the clouds the number of hours is reduced, right? And then in monsoon months the number of hours are very less, but you start recovering in September and then October and so on, right? But again, days are shorter in December, so you have less sunshine hours in December, right? So this type of measurements are can be found. Of course, you can't get a very perfect number using a sunshine recorder, but it should be replaced with a sensor which gives you this type of number of hours for which the clear sunshine or the irradiance above a particular value was available at a particular location. Okay. So this was about different solar radiation measurement instruments. Now, generally, we are not interested in the instantaneous value of solar radiation, right? Like as you might have noticed in these months, let's say towards the end of June or in the beginning of July, maybe up to 15th of July, what you find is that when there is no cloud, the solar radiation intensity is very high. But then in a short period of time, the cloud may come and that may reduce it drastically, right? So at a particular point of time, very high amount of radiation is available, and but then the number of hours in total for which that high magnitude was available may be actually less. So normally the availability of solar energy don't just depend upon the instantaneous intensity. It also depends upon the period for which it was available. So instantaneous measurement has very less value. You have to measure it continuously. And that is what will be also done whenever you are using either pyranometer or pyreliometer or such instruments, right? So you, of course, if you are doing some short period experiment on a solar collector, you might note down it at a, like, and those experiments have to be done on a clear day. So you are sure that, yes, today is a clear day, or during the experiment also, you make sure that like there are no clouds coming during the period of the experiment. So at that time you may be measuring it, the instantaneous readings, at an interval of, let's say, 5 minutes or 10 minutes or 15 minutes or something. In such cases instantaneous measurement may be done. But let's say you are talking about a weather station, so instantaneous readings are they are very frequently taken, and then they are averaged over some period of time, or a cumulative value is found, right? So during the day, the whole day, how much solar energy was available? So what is kilojoule per second per meter square, right? Watt per meter square is joule per second per meter square. So you measure it throughout, like you measure it, let's say every second, and for each second it will be different, and then you make the sum of that, right, and divide it by 3600, so you get the average of that hour, right? And then whatever was the average of each hour, 24 hours, or let's say whatever number of hours, 11 hours for which the sunshine was available, you add them. So it can become watt hour or kilowatt hour per meter square, right? And you may convert it into kilojoule per meter square, or this megajoule per meter square, right? So that's the exercise which is many times done. And most of the charts that you see, sometimes you come across the solar energy availability chart, right? So those chart would give you solar energy availability in terms of like megajoule per meter square in a month, or over a year, or average value for a month during a day, right? Or it can be even in kilowatt hour per meter square. So you can look at this diagram, which like this is the day, and it means time during the day, right? 12 night to 12 midnight here, and the sunrise is occurring here. So this red color line basically shows the instantaneous intensity at a given point of time, right? So you can see like maximum value what was available was around 700, right? It could be a winter day, so the irradiance value may not be highest, intensity may also not be very high, or it may be someplace at a high latitude, so again the irradiance values may not reach a very high peak value. So these are the instantaneous values, but then you are finding out like whatever you got here and multiplied by time period. So the area below this curve, right, basically like you can see this yellow color area highlighted here. So between 12 and 6, how much solar energy was available? So if you find that area, like watt per meter square into time, right, what is kilojoule per second, and if you convert time into seconds, then that second gets cancelled, so it will become joules per meter square, right? So that way you can get the cumulative value, or what you can do is you can, like, whatever energy is collected, calculated, you go on adding it, so you get the cumulative value, right? So up to the sunset time it goes on increasing, so this cumulative value may be like represented in megajoule per meter square, right? So like kilowatt hour, so hour is a time unit, 3600 seconds. So if you multiply it, basically kilowatt hour is an energy unit, as you all know. Either you can represent it in megajoule or kilojoule per meter square or kilowatt hour per meter square. So that cumulative value generally is of more value than the instantaneous value, right? So those cumulative values are hourly average values of representative of a month are given in such tables. So this is for Ahmedabad. Let's say in January, during between 10 and 11, how many megajoules are available per meter square? So you can see between 10 and 11, 2.26 is megajoule per meter square is available. It increases between 11 and 12. It remains almost at the same value between 12 and 1 p.m. Right? Again, goes on decreasing. So this is monthly average for a particular time period, or it can be for a representative day of the month. So these kind of values are like they are based on the readings taken on the at the weather stations, and this could be available to you. So if you want to get what is the potential or what is the input energy, whether I should put it up at Ahmedabad or not, right? If I get the data for, let's say, Shillong here, I might find that, oh, it's cloudy most of the times and these intensities are low, so input itself is low, so I should not be putting up a solar collector here, right? So it basically gives you the potential of the solar energy availability at a particular location. So that is more helpful to take a decision whether a particular place is the right place for putting up solar collectors or not. One thing, this was global, and then similar like diffuse also may have been measured, and beam also may have been measured. So you can pick up the table which is of interest to you. Now the next thing we will talk about is solar radiation on an inclined surface, right? Okay, but I think we'll take it in the next lecture.